So, welcome everybody. Thanks for coming. Before I start, a little disclaimer. First of all, on the printout on the agenda, you see Ahmad as speaker. He is from Egypt, and the EU was not fast enough to give him a visa. That's the diplomatic way of saying it. I don't know whether he would have gotten one. So, since I was giving an AI talk in the morning, I volunteered to give his talk in the afternoon. So that's the first disclaimer. So I'm not the original speaker, but I'm a lecturer for blockchain at the university, so I have quite a good background about blockchains. And the second thing is that since version 1.3 of Hyperledger, the Hyperledger composer, where this talk was going to be based on, has been deprecated. So it doesn't make too much sense to base this talk on Hyperledger Composer. So I will talk a bit more about the concepts. And I will also, as a refresher or starter, show you something about Bitcoin and Ethereum in order that you can contrast Hyperledger against Bitcoin and Ethereum a bit better. So if you are still with me, feel free to stay. Otherwise, please feel free to go to another parallel talk. So, okay, nobody is leaving the room. Good. So then, let's start with a little refresher on Bitcoin and Ethereum, and then go to Hyperledger later. So, who of you knows how Bitcoin works? Okay, who of you knows how Ethereum works? Okay, I would say 25% of the audience. Okay, so let's do a little Ethereum Bitcoin crash course here. So a Bitcoin is a state transition system. That means you have state. That's what is residing on the blockchain. And if you want to change the state, you always have to go through a transaction. And if you apply a transaction on a state, then you get a state prime. That's basically an updated version of the state. Every transaction has to be valid. So it has to be signed with a private key. And only if that signature is valid, the nodes are executing the transaction against the state. And if every node does the same, so if every node checks whether the transaction is correctly signed and applies the transaction at a given state, then the state prime should be the same on all the other parallel versions of the blockchain. There's some variation of that. Actually, it's not a transaction, so we are applying blocks on the state, and a block is a set of transactions, and also the order matters, of course, but that's just a detail. So mathematically, it looks like apply function, where you apply a transaction tx to a state s, and either you get the state prime back or an error. For example, if the transaction is not valid because it's not correctly signed, or if the contents of the transactions are not valid. For example, you are spending more than you have. That's something which some governments should also consider. So you see here an example of a valid transaction. From that perspective, Alice and Bob have $50, and Alice sends $20 to Bob. So the new state S prime is Alice has $30 and Bob has $70. So given that transaction is correctly signed, the Bitcoin nodes would execute that transaction. If you now apply an invalid transition, for example, you want to send $70 from Alice to Bob, you get back an error. So Bitcoin is a single-purpose tool. It's just for transferring money from A to B in a secure way. Then at the point in time, Vitalik, who is the founder of the Ethereum Foundation and the brain behind Ethereum, proposed to Bitcoin guys, maybe we should add some functionality to Bitcoin that in addition to that single purpose of transferring value from A to B, we can execute business logic on the blockchain in a secure way. I think his motivation was that he was posting some controversial stuff on some blog, and he got censored, and then he thought maybe he is not allowed to have his free opinion, and we need to have some additional functionality in a blockchain that nobody can stop him. So then the Bitcoin guys didn't like that idea for some reason. Maybe they have been afraid that they will screw up the Bitcoin protocol and you will have forks. I will explain later what a fork is. Then that was the idea that he wanted to create an alternative protocol for building decentralized applications. That's the where the idea of decentralized applications basically started. So in contrast to Bitcoin, where you only send money from A to B, Ethereum is a so-called Turing complete engine. That means everything what you can implement in any programming language should be able to run on top of the Ethereum blockchain. So it's some sort of a Bitcoin plus plus. So it has a built-in Turing complete programming language. There are many, but the most used is called Solidity. There are two types of accounts in Ethereum. One is a user account, which is private key controlled. And then there are those contracts. In Ethereum, they are called smart contracts. They are code controlled. And everybody in possession of Ether can create a contract. So it's not exclusive. You need a couple of Ether, I will explain it later, because in order to run computations on the blockchain and creating a contract is a computation, you have to pay for that computation. That's the reason why you need Ether. This is a simple example of a decentralized domain name service, which you can implement on such a blockchain. So that's Python, don't be confused. It's just for illustration purposes. So you have two functions on that contract. One is register and then one is set IP. So if you never ever have registered a domain, you call the register function. And here is an associative array, domains. And if you are already in there, it won't work. If you are not in there, then you are setting the owner and also the IP address. And then there's a set IP, that's an update function, and the only way you can update is if you're the owner. That means if you are not in the possession of the private key associated with that smart contract, there's no way in changing the IP address. Not even for the most powerful government in the world. Okay? That was the idea. And there's actually a real implementation of that on ens.domains. You can check that out. So then something interesting is the state in Bitcoin is managed differently. It's the unspent transaction output scheme. So in Bitcoin, you don't have some sort of account. There are just transactions. The money in Bitcoin comes from a specific address, which you can deduct money from while mining. I will also come to that a bit later. And then, for example, if you want to send one Bitcoin from Alice to Bob, you can just do so. But in case you want to send half of a Bitcoin to Bob, then you must include this half of a Bitcoin as a transaction back to your account. That's how it's working in Bitcoin. In Ethereum, it's more simple in that sense. So you have account objects which contain a balance, and that balance can be updated. And also, the transition of that balance is stored on the blockchain. So you know who and when this balance has been changed, but in the account itself, you only see the actual value, like it's done in a banking account as well. So every transaction specifies a to address, except the ones who create the contract. And if the address is a contract, then the code is executed. So if you don't specify a function on the contract you want to call, the specific function of that contract is executed. But you can also call specific functions within a contract. And a code in the contract itself can send Ether to other addresses. And it can read and modify storage. I come to the storage later on Ethereum. And you can also call other contracts from such a contract. So every full node processes every transaction and stores the entire state. There's a cost involved in that, of course. Therefore, if you are running a full node, normally you run a full node only if you participate in mining. There's one concern in such an environment, that's the halting problem. Maybe you've heard about the halting problem on a Turing machine. So it basically says that there's no mathematical way in determining whether a Turing machine will eventually halt. That means you can create an endless loop in a smart contract and you are not able to detect this. So this is solved in Ethereum using the notion of gas. So every computation step is charged for and you have to pay the gas for the transaction, and if you run out of gas, then basically the transaction is reverted and the gas is lost. Even storage consumption costs gas, so therefore you can basically prevent the spamming of the blockchain with irrelevant information. And you can specify how much gas you're willing to pay. And the gas price is something which is adjusted dynamically. Every transaction in Ethereum has a nonce. That means you cannot just reissue the same transaction twice. That's pretty handy, because otherwise you can continuously deduct money from one account to another. And the gas price, that's the amount of gas you want to pay. And the destination address, where your money go, where your Ether should go to, how much, that's the value. And in addition, you can specify data, and that's basically are the parameters, for example, which you pass to functions in a smart contract, and of course a signature. So again, we have this state transition function here. We have state in the blockchain, we have transactions, and then of course also the state changes. So there's another data structure in Ethereum which is called a lock. So it's stored on the blockchain. You can only append, you cannot change it. You cannot read it from the smart contracts. It still costs Ether or gas to store data on the lock, but it's 10 times cheaper than usual storage. The purpose of lock is for creating events. So since data is stored on the blockchain and you want to create the event, for example, notify somebody, you just store it on the lock, and then every full node which stores the actual state on the blockchain of the blockchain can pass and read the lock, and whether it detects, and when it detects an event, it just creates the event and sends, for example, an email or whatever. So that's the way how to create events out of a smart contract. The smart contracts are running on the Ethereum virtual machine. And here's the memory layout of the EVM. So you have a stack, so last in, first out. You have a memory segment, which is infinite, but it's kept by gas. You have to pay for usage of that memory segment. You see there are many denial of service protections built into the platform using gas. Environment variables, for example, in which block number you are, the difficulty. I come to difficulty later. I will explain mining a bit. And the long-term storage, that's the one you can also read data from in a smart contract, or the locks, which is the append-only external thing for the events. So you can only deploy pure bytecode into Ethereum, but there are many programming languages which can be compiled into EVM bytecode, but the most prominent is Solidity, and I have not heard about anything else. But of course, Python would be a very interesting variant, because it's much more common than Solidity, of course. So there is one data section in each transaction, and that's basically just encoding the parameters to the functions of a smart contract. So that's basically how that is handled. And now the hashing, so the actual proof of work. Who of you doesn't know what proof of work is in the blockchain? Okay, so I come back to that later, maybe it's the wrong order, but anyway. So the idea to secure such a public blockchain is you are only allowed to change the blockchain when you have proven that you have spent a certain amount of energy, that means external money, and that you're doing by a proof of work. So you're just running an algorithm which just spends electricity for nothing, and that's the way to prove that you have actually done a certain amount of work, and you cannot just issue transactions. You need to compute first. And the proof of work algorithm in Ethereum is called ETHash. And the idea is that it is GPU friendly and ASIC hard. So ASIC is an application specific integrated circuit, which is some sort of a processor, which is made for only computing one particular algorithm very fast. And that is in Bitcoin a problem. I come back to that later. That the algorithm in Bitcoin, which is SHA-256, has been accelerated really fast using those ASICs, and therefore the market is completely controlled by the vendors of that ASIC hardware. On the other hand, ETHash is meant to run nicely on GPUs, but the problem is there are only two major vendors of GPUs anyway. It's NVIDIA and AMD, so same problem here. And recently, they have found an ASIC for ETHash as well, so you cannot mine Ethereum on GPU anymore. It doesn't make sense because it takes too much energy. But that's how the algorithm looks like. So you don't have to understand each detail here. The important thing of ETHash is this red circle. At certain point in time, so at certain stages, there is a huge amount of data read from the GPU card's main memory. And that's actually the bottleneck. So the speed of this ETHash algorithm is determined by the speed of the main memory of your GPU card. And I think somehow they managed now to have fast memory on the ASIC as well. So this is now the problem. DAG stands for Directed Acyclic Graph. I won't go into too much detail here, but that's a data structure. It's a pseudo-random number. And if you access this memory area, the purpose of this DAG is that you cannot predict the access pattern, so caches won't work here. That's the idea. Otherwise, you could run it on a CPU, and your caches will make it fast. But since this is a pseudo-random distribution of values, the access pattern is random, therefore you need a high bandwidth on the complete DAG. And currently, I think it's 3 GB. And everybody thought, OK, it's impossible to have an ASIC with 3 GB of main memory. But somehow they have fixed that problem. So then there are two important concepts. What happens if you have a network partition? That means, for example, if the connection between US and Europe, the internet is broken for 10 minutes or for 1 hour, then you have, of course, nodes running Bitcoin or Ethereum in both continents, and they are constantly changing. So if they merge again, so that's called forking, by the way. That's also a way of forking. But the idea in Bitcoin is if you have two parallel blockchains, then eventually the one which is longer will win. And that's built into the source code of the nodes. That actually means all the transactions which are happening at the bottom of this blockchain in one continent, if it is the shorter one, they are getting reversed. That's the problem. Okay. Those are the Bitcoin orphans. It's important to know. So all the attacks against Bitcoin can only be done using such a methodology. That means you have to have more than 51% of the compute power of Bitcoin for a certain amount of time in order to break it. In Ethereum, it's similar, but as you might imagine, if you are just reversing transaction in a shorter chain, you are not only making the people unhappy who have sent money from A to B, but also the miners, because they have invested a lot of money into mining blocks. and afterwards everything gets reversed, including their mining reward. So Ethereum addresses that with the so-called Ethereum uncles. That means that uncles are also included in the blockchain. So the sidechains are not deleted. They're invalid, but they are included in the blockchain and also receive a reward. And the chain with the most uncles is regarded as truth in Ethereum. So one important concept in that whole blockchain space are Merkle trees. And I just want to give you an intuition on how they work. So the notion of a light client is actually an Ethereum node, which can validate transaction without downloading the complete Ethereum blockchain. And that's very handy for mobile applications or IoT applications. So this little node in that tree, consider this to be one transaction, and you want to verify this transaction. So what you need to do is you only need to go up the tree and fetch those circle transactions which are here in red and validate it against the root transaction. That's sufficient to determine whether your initial transaction is valid. You don't have to download the whole blockchain, and that's an advantage. Okay. So I have told you about events. Events is a way of sending a message within a smart contract to someone. And actually, the idea what it does is it will store that information on the lock. The lock is part of the blockchain. It's not readable from the smart contract, but it's like an inside-out communication channel. And then third-party tools can just read, so can run a full node, and just read the contents of the lock and search for specific events and act on those. And that's basically the way how to get data from a smart contract to the outside world. Because we will learn later, in Hyperledger, you can do network connections within a smart contract. In Ethereum, you can't. Because imagine if you could do that, you could run a distributed denial of service attack just by running a smart contract in Ethereum. So there are internal transactions in Ethereum which are not part of the blockchain. That occur when transactions are sent from a smart contract. I'm just having that here for completeness because I ran into that problem once and I didn't find a transaction, so that's an important thing. So then one famous example is the DAO. Who have heard about the DAO hack? Oh, not too many. Maybe you are too young. It was 2016. So as you can run Turing-complete code on the blockchain, you can run basically anything. And one idea was some sort of an open and distributed, unstoppable Kickstarter. So you could pay into the DAO. And depending on the amount of Ether you paid into the smart contract, you received voting tokens. And then you could suggest, as another person, you could suggest the project which needs funding. And based on your voting tokens, you could vote for a specific project, and then money was basically given to that project. It was a very nice idea. It was meant as an experiment, and they expected a couple of thousand euros into the smart contract. But then at 21st of May, there have been 150 million equivalent of US dollars in the smart contract by more than 11,000 investors, so it grew really large, which was nice in the one hand. On the other hand, it was bad because the DAO had many bugs and defects. So it was possible to get money out of the DAO without permission, and 11.5 million Ether has been stolen. So they couldn't steal it completely, but they just have been able to get it out of the smart contract and store it somewhere where it was inaccessible to the DAO. So the big question was what to do now. And philosophically, a blockchain should be immutable. even if the smart contract has a problem, that's a problem of the smart contract, the blockchain should be immutable. But it's always political, so some investors have been coming from the Ethereum Foundation, including Vitalik, who invested also into the DAO. And then they said, okay, we lost a lot of money, it's still the experimental phase, we just change the code of the nodes that these transactions are reversed. And then they thought, okay, if we just do that, everybody will update their nodes and we will continue like that. But that was not happening, so they actually released the code and only 90% of the nodes updated. 10% said, no, that's not correct. A blockchain should be immutable. And then is you get something which is called a hard fork. If the protocol is not compatible anymore with each other, you get a hard fork and you get basically two blockchains. And that means that if you now are in possession of a private key and you are holding Ether, you have access to the Ether on both blockchains because it's just a copy until that point in time. And when the fork happens, they are basically diverging and you are continuing to have access to the Ethers. That means if you owned one Ether on Ethereum after the fork, you owned one Ether on Ethereum and one Ether on Ethereum Classic. That's how they call the original blockchain. And if you look it up, you still have Ethereum and Ethereum Classic. And that's basically what hard forking means. So the last thing about Ethereum is maybe you have heard about these ICOs, initial coin offerings, and ERC tokens. So that's just a predefined interface, how you can create such a token for usage as a ICO. And there are different variants. And if you implement a smart contract and you're sticking to that interface, for example, in wallets, you can then access and manage your tokens. And I guess that around 99% of all Ethereum smart contracts are some sort of that token. And I think the 223 is still already old. So there's a new one. So these slides are like 6 months old. So a lot of things are changing. But that's basically more or less what Ethereum is and what it is used for. So the most of the applications we are seeing at the moment is creating some sort of currencies on top of the Ethereum platform. Okay, so are there any questions, comments, additions, complaints so far? Yeah? Okay, so the question was, when you transfer, for example, you own one Bitcoin and you want to transfer only half of a Bitcoin, what's the idea behind transferring the other half back to you? That's just the idea how you manage state on the blockchain. So you have two variations or two possibilities. One is you have an account, you update the value on some sort of account, which is maybe obvious and easy to understand. The other one is how Bitcoin is doing it. Is that the amount of money you own on the blockchain is determined from the very start, beginning of the of the history, going through all the transactions, you can determine how much money you are able to spend, and there is no state or no account in Bitcoin. That means if you don't send half of Bitcoin back to you, that half of Bitcoin is lost. I have to confess, I don't know what the reason was for that concept, maybe in those days to save storage, because the transaction you have anywhere on the blockchain, and using only the transaction, you can algorithmically determine the amount of money you can spend, and you don't need this additional data structure. So I suppose it's about saving storage, but yeah, that's how it, yeah?
Such as in the state of Georgia, they are registered who owns which part of the land, and land is sold to someone else. In Great Britain, there's a use case of tracking food.
Mm-hmm.
How is that related to to blockchain and not to Bitcoin?
Okay, so the question was, what about use cases beyond transfer of money, which you have in Bitcoin? For example, real estate management, for example. So in real estate, it's a bit more simple because you anyway have to include some trusted party like a government. And there the whole notion of permissioned and private blockchains comes in, which I will talk about in the remaining 2 hours. You could run such a system on Ethereum, because Ethereum initially wasn't meant as a cryptocurrency. Ethereum was a distributed, unstoppable execution engine for distributed applications, and it just needed a cryptocurrency in order to function. Okay? So in theory, if everybody agrees to use Ethereum for such a purpose, you could use it. The disadvantage is the mining costs. So you need to spend money and energy, or waste energy basically, for order to have the system working. And the volatility of the currency is also a problem, because one Ether costs every day a different price, and you can hardly predict how much you are then paying for your transaction. So I think answer that question more in detail if we cover now Hyperledger and private and permissioned blockchains. Other questions? Okay. So let's have a look at Hyperledger. But before we do that, we will do some recap, because I still haven't explained how mining works. So hashing, I assume at a developer conference I don't have to explain hashing, or anyone wants me to explain what a hash function is? Okay, just for completeness, a hash function takes any arbitrary value x, creates a hash h. This direction is fast, so But if you want to determine x from h, that's slow or impossible. In addition, a hash function is a surjective function. That means multiple value of x are mapping to a single value of h. And that additional property makes it impossible to go from h to x, because there are multiple value of x possibly creating that hash h. But anyway, this space is so huge, you won't ever have a conflict there, but that's just that recap on hashing. And the other one is RSA. So who of you could explain RSA? One. Okay, so RSA is asymmetric encryption algorithm. And that's how you initialize it. So you take two prime numbers, and you compute n from those two by just multiplying those together. So in this case, we have 29 and 31 as prime numbers, p and q, and 899 as n. Then you compute t. You just subtract one from the first and one from the second prime number. You multiply those together and you get t, that's 840. And now you find e relatively prime to t, so that means the greatest common divisor between those is 1. So for example, e equals 11. And now you find d such that d times e over t gives us a remainder of 1. That's 611. So now you have initialized RSA using two prime numbers, and you have P, Q, N, T, E, and D. And the public key is N and E, and the private key is N and D. If you want to encrypt something, you take the message, any number, to the power of e modulo n, then you get c. And let's consider we want to encrypt the character w, which is an ASCII value of 119. So we take 119 to the power of 11 modulo 899. You obtain 595 as the encrypted value. And now if you want to decrypt, we take this encrypted value to the power of d modulo n, and we get back 119. So it's 595 to the power of 611 modulo 899 is 119, and that's the same message. That actually means the property of this is that we can share the public key n and e to everybody, and if we keep d as a secret, only we can decrypt it. Okay, that's just a refresher on RSA. And then this initial idea of Turing complete blockchains, which we had first in Ethereum, there are some others now. So for example, NEO or NEM or Cardano, and there are multiple coming up. So maybe each week a new blockchain. And the notion of smart contract we already covered in Ethereum. So another thing we need to understand for Hyperledger is what an atomic broadcast is. So in a fault-tolerant distributed system, an atomic broadcast is a broadcast where all the broadcasts are executed by all the peers in the same order, and they are all executed in a sequence successfully. And if a single node can't execute a single element of the broadcast, it should be atomic. That means all the others have to roll back. That's the atomic broadcast. Then there's the notion of active and passive replication. So we have the state master, which can be a database or a blockchain or a list or whatever. And we have a process. And the process changes the state. So let's consider the process to be a transaction. It reads from the database, it changes something and writes it back. And then this state update is then copied to a state replica. So in the replica, there's no process running. Therefore, it's impossible to verify anything. Then you have active replication. That means the master can't alter the state of the replica directly. A second process on the replica side is executing the same events in the same order as an atomic broadcast, actually. And then the result should be the same. But now a process on the replica can verify things, can verify the transactions and so on. And that's the basic idea of all the blockchains. Whether they are public or private, you have always this active replication. You have then the notion of a state machine replication, which is used in nearly every public blockchain. It's a so-called order execute architecture. So first of all, you order your transactions. So if you send money from A to B in Bitcoin, you are creating a transaction. And this transaction you sign with your private key, and that you publish into the peer-to-peer network. And then eventually a miner will pick this transaction up among some others. So those are the open transactions, and creates a block specific to the miner. He decides on the order and creates a block. He starts the mining process. And then when he found a valid block, then he publishes the valid block to the peer-to-peer network, and all the nodes are verifying and then updating their own state. I forgot one thing. I wanted to... Some people raised their hand when I asked who knows about mining, how mining works. I will just double-check whether I can explain it to you in a second. So let's... I think I have some nice demonstration here. I will increase the font size in a second. Okay, so is that readable from the last row? Maybe not. No idea how to increase the fonts. Ah, that easy. Okay, so let's walk you through that code. So that's just a shell script, and that's an example for Bitcoin. So in Bitcoin, the hashing function SHA-256 is used, and it's applied twice. So what you do is you create a block containing the transactions, including one transaction which currently gives you 12.5 Bitcoins, which you can then send to your private account. And then you hash the transaction, and you include a nonce, so an arbitrary string in that transaction block, in that block, and then you increment this nonce. And you hash it again and again and again until you have a certain amount of leading zeros in the result. And since every tiny change, so that's the property of a hash function, if you change only one bit in the input, a huge amount, around 50% of the bits in the output flip. So there's no way in finding the nonce, then brute forcing it. And that's basically what proof of work is doing. So let's actually run this. So you see here, I have to increase it again. So see here, this text goes permanently and immutable into the blockchain, comma nonce. Okay? So I'm hashing this from this to the end of nonce. I'm creating this hash and I'm applying it twice. And on the right hand side you see the corresponding hash. And I'm just incrementing the nonce by one and rehashing. And I'm stopping when I have found a hash with a certain number of leading zeros. And I think this, so this is running here, if you see here. You see here, it's running only on one core, so it will take some time. And again, to the code is, if we have a certain number of zeros, then we stop. And this certain number of zeros is called a difficulty. And since the number or the amount of compute power within a blockchain network, which is based on proof of work, can continuously change, the difficulty is automatically adjusted. That in Bitcoin, for example, you have a new block every 10 minutes. So it's that difficult that all the compute power combined needs 10 minutes to find a valid block. And on Ethereum, it's always around 12 seconds. But that's a bit more variable. Yeah, we can leave that running. I think it takes 5 minutes. We can go back to that later. But that's the basic idea. Now, the mining hardware vendors have just came up with very, very fast ASICs, which can compute this SHA-256 operation very fast and efficient. So it's all about how much electricity you spend for that. Okay, again, back to this. So when my laptop stops to make noise, I know that the script is finished. So that's the order execute architecture, because you order transactions into a block, you compute the proof of work on the block, and then you distribute it, and then you have active replication. Each node takes this block, validates it. If it's valid, it applies it to the blockchain, and therefore has changed its own version of the blockchain without trusting anybody else. So that actually means that every peer needs to execute every transaction, of course. And one limitation of Ethereum and Bitcoin, all the transactions need to be deterministic, and there are some cryptographic algorithms which are based on random values. I will come to that later, how this is solved in Hyperledger. Yeah, and it's basically the way how all the blockchains are doing it. It's Tendermint, Quorum, Ethereum, and so on. So the consensus is always hard-coded. That's part of the blockchain. You cannot change the trust model. It's always proof of work. The difficulty is always adjusted that you have around 10 seconds for each transaction, or for each block, sorry. The smart contracts need to have a specific language, especially in Ethereum 1, which compiles to the Ethereum virtual machine bytecode. Every transaction needs to be executed sequentially, otherwise the state transition wouldn't be sound. You have a confidentiality problem, so every smart contract runs on every peer, so you know what is inside a smart contract per definition. Yeah, that's basically that one. And then you have a Hyperledger, which is different here, okay? So you have, everyone can dynamically deploy application, and it uses the execute order validate paradigm. So that's completely different. It's the only blockchain technology which uses execute order validate over order execute. So execute means you first execute your transaction and you check for correctness, and then you order. So this is an ordering service which is executing that task. And after that, you have policies which need to be complied to. And if they are all complied to, then the change state is then written to the persistent storage. That means every transaction is simulated first. So that's Fabric's main innovation. And every transaction is only executed by a subset of peers. So in contrast to Ethereum, where every transaction is executed by every validation node, and that's basically achieved by randomly selecting a set of peers who need to validate something, and that's deterministic but can't be controlled by individual peers. Okay, so you can, for example, easily implement this by creating a hash of the transaction and see whether the number you get back as hash is odd or even, and based on that you select a subset of peers. That's just an example how you could, for example, implement such a mechanism. Yeah, and you can add policies and define how many peers you want to have in that validation process. So you as a smart contract developer, while deploying a smart contract, you specify that. But here it's also active replication. That means only if there is consensus, so there is a consensus protocol, and in this case it's pluggable, so each contract can have a different consensus behind the scenes. But if consensus is reached, then all the nodes are updating their local copy of the blockchain. Okay, here once again. So peers are ordering and validating transactions. And also peers are solving that proof of work puzzle. Let's see how my puzzle is done. You see here, I have found a hash. So if you add the nonce 25820 to this string and you hash it twice, then you get a hash which has three leading zeros. Let's double check if that is true. So let's say echo this string, and we say I think it's open SSL something, this one here. So we do that twice, and let's double check if this really works. Oh. Yeah, see here, that's actually the proof. And you see here, that was fast, no? So this computing, this hash, or this nonce basically, took 5 to 10 minutes. But verifying the nonce only takes us 13 milliseconds. Okay, that's the idea. In one way, finding the hash and the block is computationally intensive, but validating everybody can do really fast. Okay. So, that's the peers are solving those proof of work puzzles, and the lucky peers, so those one who have found the correct nonce and the correct hash, are then allowed to broadcast the transaction and they get the reward. But every peer needs to repeat that execution, and all transactions are executed sequentially. And those are basically the limitations. Because you have sequential operations, the throughput is basically 1 over execution latency, and only deterministic executions are supported, and active replication for the source code disclosure, which is obvious, no? And the trust model is fixed and hard-coded in Ethereum and all those public blockchains. So let's have a look at Fabric, how we address all the limitations of public blockchains. And I have to say one thing clearly, it's not about competing against Ethereum or public blockchains. Those are two different tools for two different purposes. Okay, one is maybe that smash the banks and decentralize everything, censorship resistant thingy which you have in those public blockchains, and the private and permissioned blockchains are much more, let's say, large enterprise friendly, because they are actually empowering also large enterprises of using blockchain technology. So you see here, it's meant for distributed application execution, and the critics of a private blockchain basically say a private blockchain is nothing else than a database, and I will show you that it's a bit more than just a database. It also ensures consistency and ensures immutability, but also, of course, it has limitations. Yes, you can tweak the data if you, for example, have a consortium of 10 participants and you somehow can convince 7 of them to cheat, then of course the system is vulnerable. Okay. The idea is you have general purpose languages for the smart contracts. So in Fabric, the smart contracts are called chain code, and you can now implement the chain code in Go, Java, and Node.js. So Go was the first, then I think in version 1.1, Node.js came, and since version 1.3, there's Java support, and that's basically, in my opinion, also the reason why they've deprecated the Composer, which I will show you later, which allowed you very easily to create such chain code. But since we have now easy languages like Node.js and Java, maybe that's not necessary anymore. So the execution history is also tracked in an append-only replicated ledger. So that's how a blockchain works, basically. But it hasn't a built-in cryptocurrency, and the reason for that is that it doesn't use mining. So there is no reward in validating transactions. You can easily build a cryptocurrency on top of Hyperledger. That's very easy. We can even do that later, if you like, in 2 minutes. But the idea is that the blockchain is not based on the cryptographic currency. And it introduces the execute order validate blockchain architecture in contrast to order execute. So distributed applications on Fabric, you have the smart contract, also known as chain code. It runs during the execution phase, and it may be written by an untrusted developer. And the system itself has chain code, so every operation, every admin operation on Hyperledger Fabric is also backed by chain code, That means it also runs on top of the blockchain, and that means it also audits every change you do to the blockchain in the blockchain itself. So you have a clear audit trail here as well. There is notion of an endorsement policy. I come to that later, which cannot be changed by an untrusted developer, but by a trusted one. So designated administrators can change the endorsement policies. And the chain code specifies the endorsers for transactions. So I will explain you what endorsers are. So endorsement means a client sends a transaction to a peer according to the endorsement policy. That means if you are running a transaction against the chain code and the one who has deployed the chain code also deployed a corresponding policy. And this policy says, for example, in order to execute this transaction, you need to have endorsements of at least 7 peers or of at least 70% of all peers or whatever. And then what happens is that the transaction is sent to the endorsers. So every endorser has a copy of the blockchain, and those peers are simulating the transaction. So this transaction is executed, and the read-write set is generated based on a transaction and the current state of the blockchain. And then this read-write set is signed by the private key of each peer and sent back to the client. Once you have the endorsement from the required number of endorsers, you can send this transaction to an orderer. I will come back to that later. On the orderer, you have a pluggable consensus protocol. So you can, there are two or three built in as plugins in Hyperledger, but it's a public interface and you can implement your own consensus protocol in Hyperledger. So in theory, you could add a proof of work consensus protocol or a proof of stake consensus protocol, and you can build every type of cryptocurrency and blockchain you can imagine. But the strength is that you actually don't need proof of stake or proof of work. By the way, for those who don't know what proof of stake means, in contrast to get permission to create a block by proof of work, by computing something, you can also create get a permission of creating a block if you own a certain amount of a cryptocurrency inside a blockchain. That's another way of controlling who can actually add blocks to the blockchain. It's less secure, in my opinion, than proof of work, but of course less power consuming. The orderer can make sense of the order where the transactions have to be executed, which was happening during the execution phase. So the dependencies are determined. They are grouped into blocks as usual, and then they are broadcasted to all peers. So in small installation, you can connect the peers, for example, using a Kafka queue, but you can also use a distributed peer-to-peer protocol, which uses gossip. And then you have the validation. So each peer validates stage changes from the endorsed transaction. It validates the endorsement policy. So there's a policy attached to each chain code. And it validates the consistency of the execution. And the peers validate transactions in the same order. So the validation is deterministic. So Fabric introduces a novel hybrid replication paradigm that's taken from white paper in the Byzantine model. So there are two types of fault tolerance. One is the crash fault tolerance model. That's a model where if any random host of the distributed system fails, then you are fault tolerant and you are not ending up in an inconsistent state. But in the Byzantine model, the model is harder to achieve because it also supports if a certain number of nodes in the system are acting in an adversarial way, so they try to cheat and the system is still resistant to that. Okay, that's the Byzantine model, which combines passive replication, the pre-consensus computation of state updates, and active replication, the post-consensus validation of execution results and state changes. So it uses the passive replication scheme at the endorsement time and the active replication after execution of the transaction. So here are some terms. Nodes form a network. That's pretty obvious. You have that in public blockchains as well. It's permissioned. That means, so the public blockchains are called permissionless. It's permissioned, so nodes have an identity in contrast to a public blockchain, because there a node doesn't have an identity. Everybody can participate without needing a permission from anybody. You can have a membership service provider which can make use of existing databases, user databases, and nodes can have three roles. One is an endorser, a validator, or an executor. So here you see you have the MSP, the membership service provider, and here you have this peer-to-peer protocol, and you have an SDK which takes care of this process. So if you call a transaction from the client SDK, it takes care of first endorsing the transaction and then sending it to the orderer and then waiting until all the validators have validated. So you don't have to really know how this is done if you're using the SDK, but of course it makes sense if you want to assess the security of the system. Yeah, as I said, there are different ways of getting those members into the system, but that's way too much for now. But it's, you see, it's all based on X509 certificates. And that's basically how the Fabric CA component works. So per default, it uses the X509 certificates without any external registry, and it's all based on those certificates. That means if you don't want to use the Fabric tools, you can use OpenSSL as well. So it's fully compatible to X509. It has a high availability mode, the membership service, and properties in the certificate are used to define users and roles and rights. And as I said, you can attach it to other membership services like LDAP, Active Directory. Okay, so then you have the first role, the clients, which I said, they submit a transaction proposal for execution. They help to orchestrate the execution phase, so they they read the policy attached to the chain code, they see how many endorsement responses are needed, they send the transaction to the endorsers, get the endorsement, they receive it back, they send it, they broadcast the transactions for ordering, so that's all done in the client. The peers, they execute the transaction proposals without changing the blockchain, they validate the transactions afterwards, and they maintain the state, they maintain the actual blockchain. And many different technologies are supported. It's also pluggable. You can use MongoDB or CouchDB or whatever database you like. Of course, someone else can change then the database on your peer, but actually that doesn't really concern you, because it's a replicated system, and if one admin of one node can change one database, that means he cannot change the other databases. And that's the same for public blockchains as well. You can, of course, of one node change your blockchain, but nobody cares because there are so many other replicas which represent the true state of the system. The blockchain ledger is an append-only data structure which records all transactions as a hash chain. That's always the case. I haven't mentioned that. It's also in Bitcoin and Ethereum the case that you include a hash of the previous transaction or transactions in the current block. And that's one crucial part I have forgot to tell. That's a crucial part, because that means you cannot change a block so easily. because all the previous blocks are somehow linked together because of the hashes of the previous blocks are included. So you cannot attach one block to something else. You always have to maintain this order. Yeah, and that's also important. Not all peers need to execute all transaction proposals, so it saves execution time because the policy says how many endorsements are required. And only a subset of peers have to be endorsing peers or endorsers. That means you also save on the compute power. You can just run ordinary peers, and the policy specifies how many peers you need. So a peer looks like this. So you have the endorser, the committer. So the endorser has executor. All the executions in Hyperledger Fabric are done in a Docker container. And the committer is responsible for validation and configuration and system chain code. The ledger is actually the layer on top of the database, which resembles in the key value store, basically. And then you have the gossip component. If you are running in a peer-to-peer fashion, you have a gossip component, which runs the peer-to-peer communications protocol. But as I said, you can use simpler means of communication, like, for example, a Kafka queue. And then you have the ordering service nodes. They are unaware of the application state, so they don't need the blockchain. They just are responsible for taking the endorsed transactions, putting them into order, and sending them again to the peers for validation and execution. So this design choice renders consensus in Fabric as modular as possible and simplifies the placement of consensus protocols in Fabric. So that's maybe an important statement, because you might ask yourself, why is it so complicated? Why have I used nearly 1 hour to explain how this is working? Because if you do those design choices, you design a blockchain system which has a pluggable mechanism for storing data, which has a pluggable mechanism for connecting nodes, and also for the consensus. So then we have a high-level transaction flow. Makes it maybe a bit more clear. So you have the client SDK. That's number one. That's the chain code execution. And you see here that one goes to three endorsing peers, peer one, two, and three. And the result is the endorsement. So you get an endorsement response from all those three endorsing peers back to your invocation SDK. And once you have that three endorsements, so those are three, because in the policy of the chain code, it is specified if you want to invoke a transaction on that chain code, you need to have three endorsements. Therefore, you have sent three endorsement requests to three different endorsing peers, and you receive three endorsement responses. And those three endorsement responses, which contain this read-write set, are assigned by the peers, of course, and sent to the ordering service. And the ordering service puts them into order, among many other transactions, and then sends the transaction to the endorsing peers, where they are really executed and validated. You see here also you have a non-endorsing peer, which just simply trusts the ordering service and just replicates what's happening, but it's still active replication because four is sending the read-write set to the peers, and based on the read-write set, the actual blockchain state is updated. Then we have the transaction flow execution phase. So this is basically the data structure, how it looks like. You have this endorsement request, which goes from the client SDK to the endorsing peers. So you have your identity as a submitting client according to the membership service provider. So that's the idea of your certificate. You have a transaction payload where you have encoded the operation to execute on the blockchain. You have a nonce, That's usually the case in every blockchain to ensure that every transaction is unique, or every block is unique, or whatever where the nonce is attached to. And you have a transaction identifier, which is then basically a combination of the client ID and the nonce that makes every transaction unique in respect to the sender and in respect to the version. So the endorser takes this and simulates the operations to execute against the actual state. And there are very simple and specific operations to change state. You see here there's a get state, a put state, and a del state operations. And that's against the key value store API. That means you can only mutate the blockchain state by get state, put state, and del state operations. Those are then eventually ordered, and those are basically this famous read-write set, which the endorser sends back to the SDK. As in Ethereum, chain code in Hyperledger Fabric can execute other chain code, and that's just resulting in a more blown up read-write set because the other call chain codes add further to state changes to the read-write set. So the result of the simulation is the write set consisting of the state updates and the read set where actually it is specified which keys are read during execution. And using the read and write set, then of course the orderer can order all the reads and writes in the correct order in order to create a consistent block containing multiple transactions. Yeah, and every, by the way, every key has a version. That's maybe also interesting. And then during the execution phase, this is the endorsement response that's sent from the endorser node back to the client SDK, which contains the read set, the write set, the transaction ID, the transaction ID, the endorser ID, so which endorser was responsible for creating this endorsement response, and of course the signature that later the orderer and the validator can make sure that the endorsement response came from a specific endorser and was complying to the endorsement policy specified in the policy file against the chain code. Endorser signs the endorsement request and returns the response. And if the client has enough responses based on the chain code, then he can actually send this to the ordering service. Yeah, that's what I've said. Okay. Transaction flow ordering phase. So that's the phase where now the orderer has a list of these endorsing responses, which have been created by the endorsing peers and have been sent to the orderer by the client SDK. And now he checks if all the endorsement responses are correct, if the block at sequence ID S is the same, that means if all the peers, so all the endorsers, are basically have created the endorsement response based on the same state of the blockchain, because otherwise this also wouldn't work. There's this hash chain integrity. As I said, the hash of the previous block is also stored in the block. There's the notion of no skipping. That means if a correct peer delivers block B of state S, then it delivers blocks for BI in the same sequence. That's basically also important. And if a transaction TX exists in a block B, then every transaction has been broadcast by some client. That means you cannot have a transaction in the blockchain which has not been created by a client. It is very important that the ordering service does not maintain any state of the blockchain and neither validates nor executes transactions. This architecture is crucial, defining feature of Fabric and makes Fabric the first blockchain system to totally separate consensus from execution and validation. So just take the statement for granted, because that comes from the white paper. I haven't understood why it is necessary to have those three separated components, but I understood that you need the ordering service being separated from the blockchain and the validation process in order to have this pluggable consensus. In the transaction flow validation phase, the endorsement, so that's the last phase, the endorsement policy specifies how many times or how many different peers have to validate a transaction in a block. There's a read-write conflict check using version numbers and keys in the read-write set on the blockchain state. Actually, that means if, for example, during endorsement, the blockchain had state S, and afterwards the blockchain somehow has changed, and the write set wants to change state S, but it's already in state S prime, then the transaction gets rejected. So it's an opportunistic locking mechanism here. And then finally, after all that huge process, we can really update the blockchain state based on the write set. In contrast to public blockchains, also invalid transactions are stored in the ledger. That means any attempts of tampering with the blockchain are also recorded and basically are bound to a X509 certificate. So you know who wanted to cheat. So then there's a notion of channel. So as you might know, Bitcoin, Ethereum, the whole blockchain is public. If you know which public key belongs to whom, you know all the transaction history of everybody. And in Hyperledger, you can create a channel. A channel is a means of data isolation, so only the peers which are participating in a channel are seeing that data. Every party must accept an additional party to join. Peers are taking part in the channel. You can add and remove peers during runtime on the fly. You can have different separated blockchains connected to the same ordering service at the same time. So it's a multi-tenancy architecture, and each such blockchain is called a channel and may have different peers as its members. Okay, so it's interesting that the same infrastructure can run multiple blockchains in parallel. So the smart contract business logic is called chain code in Hyperledger Fabric. As I said, it's supporting Node.js, Go, and Java. Since version 1.3, Java is officially part, before it was experimental. And you are not limited in what you can use. So as long as it compiles and it is able to run in a Docker container, you can use it. And you can make external network calls. And that's an important feature, because then you can, for example, in a chain code, update the state of an external database or call another service. The chain code runs inside such a channel, and every peer needs to install and instantiate it, and of course that can be automated. So as I have talked a lot about policies, for example the endorsement policies, how many endorsements you need per transaction, that is all defined in such a policy. Every chain code has a policy file attached, that's just I think a JSON or YAML file. And an example is, for example, 2 out of 5 possible different organizations must sign, or any member of any organization must sign, or 2 specific certificates both must sign. So you can very granularly define what is enforced for each chain code. That's the policy file. So that's an example of such a policy file. Okay, here recap. So a peer may be part of one or many channels. Every single channel has a separate ledger. Every channel has one or more chain codes, and every chain code has a different policy. Okay, so before I conclude with that part, here again, maybe a picture of the whole process. You remember you have the SDK. I know I told you that many times, but that's, I promised the last time. So you have the SDK, just to make it really clear, the SDK is used to create a transaction. The transaction proposal is sent to the peers. the endorsing peers, and how many peers you need is defined in the policy. The policy is part of the chain code. So for example, if the policy says you need 3 endorsements, then you send it to 3 peers, you get endorsement responses back from the endorsing peers. It's back on the SDK, and then you go and send those endorsements to the orderer. And if the orderer is happy, it sends the transactions to the peers, and that's the validation phase. If that is successful, then the state is updated. So, are there any questions, comments, complaints, additions so far? Okay, so I will just introduce Hyperledger Fabric Composer, even if it's deprecated. So you see, half a year ago, I said, this will change your life. Then it has changed my life, and now it changes my life again because they deprecated it. But just to give you an idea, it makes development of smart contracts really easy. And I will show you the Composer only for one reason, because it adds clarity what's really necessary for such an application. So that's the architecture of the Composer. It had one model file which was specifying like a .h file in C++, which was specifying all the meta information like the assets, transactions, and participants. Then it had a transaction file which was basically just a simple JavaScript file. And it has had an access control file which more or less was the same like a policy file. And then a query file, which made it easy for third-party developers to query the blockchain state. So you could write some SQL syntax in order to get data out. And then those 4 files have been compiled into a banana file, a BNA file, which was just a zip file out of those 4. And that you could deploy to Hyperledger Fabric. And that was it. So it was really great. And you even had a Composer REST service, which took such a business network architecture and created REST endpoints for all of your transactions. See, the CTO file is similar like a header file in C or C++, which defines assets, participants, and transactions. But it's important to notice that those are the 3 things you anyway only define in chain code. You see here, you had, for example, an enum type where you had product types, and another enum which defines shipment status. And then in the JavaScript file, the actual chain code was expressed. And you see here you have had asset registry, and you called update, and you just could send an object to the update function, and all was done for you in the background. So basically, this BNA file was cross-compiled to some execution engine written in Go on the Hyperledger system. And then you could also define the functions, so payout, shipping received as a parameter, and the state transitions had been implemented in JavaScript. And this is basically a more simple version of a policy file. That's the ACI file, which then was used to create the policy file. And that's the Composer REST server. You see here, whatever transaction you have defined in the Hyperledger Composer, the REST service has read this banana file and created REST endpoints for you. And a colleague of mine has created a little demonstration of that even. So it is an IoT asset tracker using a Hyperledger blockchain. So he has installed the Composer and the REST service and a little asset tracker, and he actually ran around to create some interesting things like a geofence. So whenever he was leaving the geofence, an event has been recorded to the blockchain. And he has implemented that using Node-RED. For those who don't know Node-RED, Node-RED is an open source tool which is implemented in my team, which is a data flow editor based on Node.js, where you can simply drag and drop functions. And if you want to go more complex, you can also put JavaScript functions in there. And he has used this tool for interacting with an IoT device and with a blockchain through REST. And of course, now he needs to update his article because the composer is deprecated. So if you want to know more about this, we have a couple of articles which are more or less explaining everything what I explained to you in more detail, and also a couple of exemplars. But most of those are still based on Hyperledger Fabric Composer. And that means for the IBM team, there is some work to do in order to migrate those exemplars to real smart contracts in either Go, JavaScript, or Java. So the only thing what's missing here is that I show you the Hyperledger Composer. Again, it's getting deprecated. So it's version 1.2, it's still there. In version 1.3, it's deprecated, and most likely in version 1.4, it's not there anymore. And then you simply cannot use it, because if the API of the Hyperledger system changes, then the composer won't work anymore. But here is just a small and little example. So you have a README, you don't need a README. You have here the metadata, like the header file. You have, for example, an asset which you want to track, for example. You have a participant, you have a transaction, and an event. So those four different type of entities you can define. And that's also the case for a normal Hyperledger chain code. Then you have the actual implementation, and you have, for example, here this sample transaction, which you annotate correctly. And what it does, it just updates the value of the asset. So if you see here, you have asset. This asset has a value. Maybe zoom in. I wanted to zoom in. Yeah. And we are just updating this value. And then we have here the policy file, which actually tells who can do what on the system, so which role you need to execute which transaction, and so on. So let's do a little test here so we can deploy. And that's pretty cool, because it runs a test environment within your browser in JavaScript. So if you are then happy with your application, you can export it as a banana file and deploy it to the real blockchain. So let's actually I get rid of that. I was just testing that before. So let's start from scratch. So let's create a participant, Mr. DevOx. And then it's 7708, and we create a new asset. And we say create new. And now, if you want to change this, we need to submit a transaction. So we have the sample transaction, and we say it's test one. So we're updating the value of the asset. Oh, sorry, we have to use the correct asset ID, which is 9022. So you see here, we have now in the blockchain, we have a sample transaction where we can view the record, where we set the new value to test one. We have a transaction ID, and also, this created an event. As we have events in Ethereum, we have events also here in Hyperledger Fabric. And in the asset, we should see now test one. Okay, so let's do one thing. Let's create a change the chain code and say the new value is has some additional string here appended. So we deploy it. And if we now submit a transaction and set the new value to test two, we should see that string appended. Oh, again, of course, we have to change the correct asset ID 9022. So, test 2, and that's asset ID 9022. So you see here that additional string is then appended, okay? And that gives you maybe, hopefully, the intuition how this all works. That means there's the only way to change some state on the blockchain is through a chain code, and the chain code then is managed through the Hyperledger system, and every change to the chain code and every change to assets or anything on the blockchain is recorded in a transaction and fully auditable. Okay, so I give you back 91 minutes because I don't have to show you more. But of course, I'm open for, again, questions, comments, complaints, and additions. Otherwise, I wish you a happy afternoon and maybe see you tomorrow.